If you're new to photography and you're a beginner, you're probably shooting in automatic mode. This is fine to start, but you're definitely going to want to learn to shoot in manual mode quickly. If you're not quite ready to take that leap into shooting in manual mode just yet, you can stay shooting in automatic mode, but you should make some adjustments to your camera settings so you can get the best images or videos that you can. If you don't know where to start, watch this video. I'll show you how to initially set up your camera and then set 7 DSLR and mirrorless camera settings to ensure that you get the best images and videos you can. Be sure to stay tuned to the end to find out how to get my free DSLR and mirrorless camera cheat sheet that'll have you shooting like a pro in no time. Hi, I'm Jim Costa. I'm a videography, photography, and technology guru, and I created many other videos on improving your photography, videography, filmmaking, video editing, audio recording, and technology skills, and I'll link to those in the description below, and both during at the end of this video, so stay tuned. If you want to learn more, remember to subscribe to my channel and hit that bell to be notified when I upload new videos. I upload every week, and I'll be uploading many more explanations of film, video, photo, editing, and technology topics. Many beginning photographers often wonder what camera settings they should use to get the best possible results with their current camera gear. While there is no set rule for camera settings that work well in every shooting environment, there are some settings that are universal across all brands of cameras on the market. These are the base settings you want to set your camera to initially. Once they're done, you probably won't revisit them. In addition, there are particular camera modes that make the process of capturing images or videos quicker or easier, especially for someone who's just starting out. Let's start with your initial camera setup. First, let's go over some of the camera settings that should apply to any modern digital camera. You should be able to find all these settings specified below, since they are more or less universal across different camera brands and models. Some of these have the same name across different manufacturers, and some have different names, so I'm going to list different names where applicable. Image quality should be set to RAW. RAW recording should be set to lossless compressed if this feature is available. White balance should be set to auto. Picture control / picture style / creative style / film simulation should be set to standard. Color space should be set to RGB. Long exposure noise reduction should be set to on. High ISO noise reduction should be set to off. Active lighting / DRO, HDR, lens corrections, sometimes vignette control, chromatic aberration control, distortion control, etc. Any features like this should be set to off. Don't worry if you missed any of these. I'll list them below in the description for you so you'll have them in writing and easy to follow at any time. The above are the most important camera settings, so let's review each of them. First, you always want to start out by selecting the proper file format, which should be in RAW. If there is a setting for selecting RAW compression, always select lossless compressed, since it reduces the amount of space your RAW files consume on your media card. While things like picture controls don't matter for RAW images, they only impact the way the image appears on your camera's LCD screen, it's best to stick with a standard profile without tweaking any other settings like sharpening, contrast, saturation, and so forth, as such settings only matter if you shoot in JPEG format, but not when you're actually shooting in RAW. The same is true with color space and white balance. You do not have to worry about them when you shoot in RAW, since you can change them later. Unless you know what you're doing, I would keep long exposure noise reduction turned on, since it does affect your RAW images when you're shooting long exposures. It works by reducing the amount of noise you'll see in your images, although it will also double the amount of time it normally takes to capture an image. It's a trade-off, but an important one worth taking to keep the noise in your images down. All other in-camera lens corrections, dynamic range optimizations, and noise reduction options should all be turned off as well, since they do nothing to improve your RAW images. Once you have the above initial settings set up on your camera, it's time to move on to things that matter when you actually take pictures. Do you have any trouble with your camera settings? If so, leave a comment below and I'll be happy to try and help you. Be certain to let me know the make and model of your camera and the specific setting you're having trouble with so I can get you the best solution. Also, be certain to check out some of my other videos on camera tips and tricks. I'll leave links to them in the description below. So what is the best camera shooting mode? If you're shooting in automatic or auto mode, you'll find that most cameras have gotten really good at properly metering a scene and exposing the subject. Aperture priority does a great job as it gives you full control, not just over camera aperture, but also how bright or dark an image will appear overall. If your camera takes a brighter image than you would like it to be, simply use the exposure compensation button to adjust the exposure and you're all set. The exposure compensation button looks a lot like this image here. If you're wondering whether it is good to shoot with any of the scene modes of your camera, such as macro or sports or fireworks or any others, I would discourage the use of these different modes for a number of reasons. The main reason is that such modes vary greatly, not just between different camera manufacturers, but also between different camera models within the same manufacturer. If you learn to always rely on a particular scene mode on one camera and decide to upgrade to a new one in the future, you might not be able to find the same scene mode on a different camera model. It's also important to highlight that most higher-end and professional cameras don't even come with scene modes in the first place. If you get too reliant on these specialized modes, you may actually be limiting yourself from growing your camera skills. The settings on most of these modes can be achieved by learning to shoot in manual mode anyway, so why even bother? Next is the best autofocus mode. You should always make sure that you're shooting in the best autofocus mode depending upon what you're photographing. For example, if you photograph a still subject, you might want to use single area focus mode, also known as single area AF, one shot AF, or simply something like AF-S. Whereas if the subject you are photographing is continuously moving around, you'll want to switch to continuous/AI servo focus mode, since you would probably want your camera to actively track your subject. To make things easy for beginners, camera manufacturers sometimes include a hybrid mode that automatically switches between single area focus mode and the continuous/AI servo focus mode, depending upon whether your subject is still or moving. This hybrid mode, which is known as AF-A on Nikon or AI Focus AF on Canon, for example, can be great autofocus modes to default to if you find it too difficult to constantly switch between the AF-S and the AF-C camera modes. Set it to that and the camera will do the work for you so you don't have to. Some cameras also come with an auto AF mode, which looks at the whole scene and tries to focus on either the nearest subject to the lens or the subject that the camera thinks is important. I would actually recommend avoiding using such modes for beginners because it's better to have control over exactly where your camera focuses by moving your focus point to the spot that your camera should focus on. You can achieve this by switching to the single point AF area mode. This mode tells your camera that one spot within the frame is what you want to focus, essentially. Once you have a single point to move around in your viewfinder, you can either move that focus point within your frame to your subject or area of interest, or move your subject to the focus point, such as in this image you're seeing here, where the point of focus is on the eyes. What is the best metering mode? While your camera might have a number of different metering modes, such as spot metering, center weighted metering, and something like matrix/evaluative metering, for most situations, it's best to default to the matrix/evaluative metering mode because it takes the whole scene into account and typically does a better job at exposing your subject. Look for the word matrix in the metering section of the menu and set your camera to that. The best lens aperture mode. Lens aperture not only affects how your subject is isolated from the foreground and background, but also impacts how much light actually goes through your lens. So you have to be careful about what aperture you pick in any given situation. In addition, aperture can impact things like image sharpness and the depth of field, so it's all about choosing the best aperture for your subject and your shooting environment. If you're taking pictures in low light and you want to avoid introducing camera shake to your images when shooting handheld, it's best to take pictures with the widest possible aperture your lens can provide, so that your camera can receive as much light as possible. For example, if you shoot with a 35mm f1.8 lens, you might want to keep that aperture set at f1.8 in such condition. However, if you're standing at a beautiful overlook like the Grand Canyon and you want to capture a sharp photograph of the whole landscape, stopping down the aperture of your lens to something like f5.6 will be optimal because it'll increase your depth of field, plus properly expose the image in most cases. Aperture is often associated with how separated your subject appears from the background, but that's only one of its many functions. In this example, you can see how different an image can appear when photographed at a wide aperture like f2.8 versus a smaller aperture like f8. This is making sense to you, put "I got it" in the comment section below. Next is the best shutter speed. Just like aperture, the choice of best shutter speed will highly depend on what you're trying to capture. For example, if your goal is to capture a dreamy photograph of a waterfall, you're going to need to use a slow shutter speed that might last several seconds to make the running water appear or that blurry, smoky look to it. Whereas, if you want to freeze a subject in your scene, you need to use very fast shutter speeds that are a very small fraction of a second to actually freeze the image. For most situations, however, you are better off using shutter speeds that are fast enough to capture images without introducing camera shake. Next is the best ISO settings. When it comes to camera ISO, you're always better off shooting with the lowest ISO possible because it produces the least amount of noise and grain in your images. The last thing you want is every image you shoot looking too noisy because you set your ISO too high. While using noise reduction techniques might help, it's better to avoid noise in the first place. Notice the noise levels in these images. ISO 200 has almost no noise at all, while ISO 3200 adds a ton of noise to the image. However, shooting at the lowest ISO is not always practical, especially when you're shooting in low light environments, such as at night. In these situations, you will need to increase your camera ISO in order to keep your shutter speed fast enough to avoid blur from a slow shutter speed that will lead to unintentional camera shake. When you have your shutter speed very slow, the aperture stays open a long time, and thus your image tends to be blurry because you move around. Remember, photography is always a balancing act between aperture, shutter speed, and ISO, known as the exposure triangle. I would recommend you spend some time to understand how these three work and how they are related to each other. I shot a video on the exposure triangle in the past, so feel free to check it out. Next is auto ISO. If you have a modern digital camera, it most likely comes with an auto ISO feature, which can be a very handy tool for a beginning photographer. Once you have the auto ISO enabled, your camera will automatically adjust your camera's ISO depending upon how bright your subject and how bright the environment you're shooting in is. Try to keep the shutter speed at the same or higher level than the minimum shutter speed you set within the auto ISO menu. Some cameras from Nikon, Canon, and other manufacturers have advanced auto ISO menus that can take into account the reciprocal rule and allow for an auto configuration for minimum shutter speed, which will take into account the focal length of the lens being used. Such options can be very useful for beginners because they take away the pain of constantly adjusting camera settings. Lastly, don't forget to take advantage of image stabilization, also known as steady shot, vibration reduction, or vibration compensation, something like that, that's offered either by your camera, known as in-body image stabilization, or your lens, known as lens stabilization. Don't forget to turn it on when shooting handheld and turn it off when shooting from a stable tripod, because it's not needed. Also, it's always a good idea to half-press the shutter release for a second or two and let your camera or lens stabilize first before actually taking your picture. This will reduce the potential for having blurry images. My question of the day is, if you're still shooting in auto mode, what's keeping you from moving to manual mode? Leave a comment below and let us know. Maybe I can help you. Now you know the minimum camera settings you need to get your camera set up for success. But what about learning more advanced camera settings to get you shooting like a pro? I've created an absolutely free cheat sheet for you on all the best camera settings for your DSLR, mirrorless, or video camera that will show you the settings that will allow your photos and videos to compete with the pros. The link to get it is just below in the video description. I've also created cheat sheets on other topics, such as video editing, and even now offer training. I'll link to those cheat sheets and training courses below as well, so feel free to check them out. If you want to join a community of photographers, videographers, filmmakers, and other people just like you, I have a secret society on Facebook where I share even more pro tips and tricks. It's called Video Producers and Content Creators. So look for that on Facebook to connect there and join the group. We love new members who want to share their work and learn from others. You'll find the link in the description below as well. You want to see even more videos like this? Follow my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films, for more. Think what you saw was great? Go ahead and like it. Do you have an opinion? Please comment below. Do you know someone who could benefit from the information that I provided? If so, then share the video. You want to learn even more? If that's the case, then connect with me, Jim Costa Films, on social media and online on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and the web. I currently have over 4,275 videos on my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films, so feel free to check out many of my other videos for great tips and suggestions. I have almost as many images, well over 4,100 right now, on my Instagram channel, so you can see how I implement these techniques that I've shown you in my own photographs. So look for Jim Costa Films on Instagram and check it out there. I'd be happy to hear your comments and any of my images, and I even answer questions from there.